Guru Brahman, Guru Vishnu, Guru Devo Maheshwara, Guru Sachar Brahman, Tasme Shri Guru Ve Nama, Tasme Shri Guru Ve Nama. Homage and prostration to Sadguru, who is Brahman, the giver of supreme bliss, who is Satpurush, the embodiment of pure consciousness itself, and the one and only one divine being without a second, vaster than the sky, infinite, eternal, beyond all time, space, and causality, beyond the three corners and their modifications, the dispeller of darkness and the bestower of light, the supreme preceptor and incarnation of divine grace. May thou leadest us from the unreal unto the real, and from death unto everlasting life. Namo Guru Bhaya. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Amen. And Happy New Year's to all you rascals, and hope this year will bring you the sought after happiness and prosperity that we all have been seeking. And I suppose something like a New Year message is expected of you, but my message is always the same, so you can pretend that you're hearing it for the first time. And I'm not even sure how happy it would make you. I got some good news, I got some bad news. And as the shepherd was pointing out, the time. Carl Sandburg said once that time is the only coin, the only wealth you have, and you shouldn't let other people spend it. Mm-hmm. How true that is. Mm-hmm. And some of us in here know firsthand how fast time flies, you see. For some of us, it seems like, as the shepherd said, it was just yesterday where little boys and girls playing happily, you see, without toys and so forth and so on. But life moves forward. And those times are all gone. And then there comes childhood, and lost in make-believe and so forth and so on. And then that's gone. Then adolescence comes, you see, and so forth and so on. You all know the story, sir. My God, how times flies. And so each new year, I suppose, it's an occasion for us to notice that, how fast this time is going. Someone once said rightly that a human lifetime is a terribly brief affair, very brief. And so time must not be wasted. So perhaps today we can talk a little bit about, say a few things about, reflect and consider the reality that you don't have all this time that you think you have, you see. And Sant philosophy, the Guru Sant, the philosophy of the masters, one of the biggest obstacles the saints point out is this illusion of time, kala. They call it kala. Sanskrit time is called kala time, the illusion that you have all this time. Big obstacle, because it deprives you of the urgency that sadhana and spiritual practice requires if you are to really succeed in it. You see, must be an urgency. Mm-hmm. So a few things will be said. You can take it as a New Year's message, but it's the same old message. And we will consider today the reality of human existence and its purpose, you see. A human lifetime is a precious thing. Not something to be wasted in frivolity. Dog, you're not children no more. So your whole life should not be devoted to fun and playing and fantasizing and that kind of thing. That's appropriate when you're a little kid. You see, you're not little kids no more. And you're not going to recover your youth. Your youth is gone. Not coming back, and you can lose as much weight as you want. Losing weight is not going to make you younger than you. And so forth and so on, you see. The purpose then of human existence, according to the teachings of the saints and sages, can be reduced to just a few things, maybe even to one thing. And they said the purpose of human existence is to know the truth. The purpose of human existence is knowledge. You have to gain knowledge. And when I say knowledge, I mean the knowledge, not academic information that you get in universities and so forth and so on. That's not knowledge that the saints are talking about, you see. But that knowledge by having which this place and this very lifetime and this very body becomes heaven. Right here. On earth. That's the knowledge. And what is that knowledge, you see? They go on to expound that knowledge consists basically of three fundamental things. I've added a fourth just to make it interesting. But knowledge of yourself. To know the real self is one of the primary forms of knowledge that is the purpose of our human existence. Now you might say, well, I know myself. Well, that remains to be seen. Most of what you know about yourself is from hearsay. It's parosha knowledge, it's not direct. They told us we were born on such and such a date and such a year, but you have no direct knowledge of that. No. It's hearsay. And so forth and so on. So knowledge of the real self is the kind of knowledge the mystics say should be what we are pursuing. And then, of course, knowledge of the real world. You see, this jagat, you see, the world that we live in is not the world that God created, Ishvara Sariti. It's a Jiva Sariti. It's the world you created. It's not the real world. You live in samsara, a world that is made in the image of your raghas and your devesas, your likes and your dislikes. That's not the real world. But you must somehow or another, by grace, gain knowledge of this world, what it is for real. And then, of course, there is the knowledge of God, real God. Because very often the God that we are praying to and so forth and so on, that's not real God. That's very often a carryover of your childish concept of God, what we call parental godism. You know, that's not real God. The God you have created out of your imagination, you see. And perhaps the fourth one that I've suggested in the past is knowledge of the process by which you may have knowledge of those three things, the self, the world, and real God, you see. So it seems then that the purpose of human existence, based on the reality of what human existence is to gain knowledge, to remove your ignorance. Now, much, much more can be said about that. But this is what there is to consider. And I know that many of us here have made New Year resolutions. I'm going to get out of debt, I'm going to lose some weight, I'm going to stop drinking, I'm going to stop smoking, I'm going to have more sex, you know, all kinds of things. But you've done all of that. There's no urgency in that. You see? The urgency is the gaining of this knowledge. That's what's urgent. That's what's urgent. That's the emergency that you must address before time's up. You see? Death is like that. Ready or not, here I come. And it's all over. And that is a tragic death. You've died. You never knew who you were. And you never knew where you are at. And you never knew how you got there. And then you die. See? You did not use your living lifetime for the purpose that it has been given to you. You needed the knowledge. It is really interesting if you read these great scriptures, no matter which culture you will explore, but certainly for most of us, we're familiar with the African and the Indian traditions, maybe the Native American traditions and so forth and so forth. And what you will find, that what distinguishes a spiritual aspect from other human beings is that the spiritual aspect is seeking exactly these three things: knowledge of self, knowledge of what this world really is, you see, and knowledge of what real God is, not this imaginary God that your mommy and daddy told you about, you see, and the means by which they may have that knowledge. This is what they're seeking. In the Atharvaka Gita, you see, Janaka, the sonification of a genuine spiritual seeker, approaches Astravaka and asks Astravaka Maharaji, how do you get knowledge? Didn't ask him how to get out of debt, didn't ask how to find a husband, did not ask how to get a wife. It did not ask how I could do better in the stock market. It did not ask how I could build a business. Did it? They don't ask about that. You asked about that. You see? They don't ask about that. They ask how to attain the knowledge. And how to attain liberation. And how to attain Rajya, dispassion. You see? Very different from us. Very different. They have realized that they are living their lives in profound ignorance. And we have not understood that yet. Ignorance, you see. You're not happy because you don't have the knowledge of how to be happy. So you're not happy. You don't know how to be happy. Fundamentally, you lack knowledge. And lacking the knowledge of how to be happy unconditionally, without any kind of psychological dependence upon this or that, this is the kind of knowledge you don't have. Hence, your bondage to this and that. You're trapped because of your ignorance. And instead of your cranking up your pursuit of knowledge, you're cranking up your pursuit of more this and that, more click-clack. You see, that's all you're doing. The Janaka, human beings like that, they want to know how to attain this knowledge. I told you, this message may not be. Don't get angry at me. You gotta play more music or something. Maybe even dance a little bit. How to attain liberation, moksha, liberation. Real freedom. Real freedom. And freedom from this, your enslavement. Maharaji, all saints talk about the fact that we are slaves. Black people, you all should have a natural aversion towards being in slavery. Now, you may not be in slavery to your oppressors anymore, but you're in slavery to the objects of your senses. Your desires, your vasanas, are your new master. It's a slavery far worse than any slavery that you will find in history. Political and social circumstances and situations. Enslaved to your vasanas. Compelled. Obsessed. No longer a master of your own mind and body. Your body, mind, masters you. It's a cruel master. So the spiritual aspirant, those who are intended to make right use of human existence, seeks this kind of liberation. and Virajya,
dispassion,
equanimity, tranquility, Samaha, tranquility, equanimity, peace. So they offer us the same deal that all great mystics have offered. But Jesus said, come unto me, all ye who are weary, right? And heavy laden, and I will give you rest. See? Just looking into your faces can see you tired. Y'all were wild. Tired. You're looking for rest. You're looking for the fruit of detachment. You see, you can't get rest because you're too attached. How can you rest? So, knowledge. The attainment of knowledge is the purpose of human existence. So now you can review your life this new year and see if knowledge is on your list of New Year's resolutions. Or is your list just more of the same old bullshit you've been chasing all of your life up until this point? Driven out of these vasanas. You see, loka vasanas, these worldly desires, principally for praise and validation and others' respect. You see? And you move around here expecting praise from every Tom, Dick, and Mary that you come in contact with. How is that possible? It's not possible. Loka vasana, fame, wealth, power, you see. Absolute security in a place where there is no security. You see, no drishti, you see. No knowledge of the jagat. You have not seen jagat the way jagat really is. So you still are laboring under all of these false expectations of the world and people. As if the world is obligated to fulfill your desire. Who told you that? Where did you get that from? It's our child. The world is not obligated to fulfill your desire. Nobody, in fact, is obligated to fulfill your desire. Your wife is not obligated. Your husband is not obligated. Your children are not obligated. Nobody and no force in the universe is obligated to fulfill your little desire. But this is your childish and wrong understanding of jagat, you see. Y'all want me to stop?
Yes, sir.
Sure. All right.
True.
I'm going to get shot. You don't understand. You don't have the knowledge. Of jagat. So you don't know how to interact and transact with jagat in a way that remain happy, tranquil, balanced. You don't know how to do that. Nor do you have knowledge of real God. So you keep praying to this imaginary God that Mommy and Daddy told you about, which does not answer your prayers. As if real God is somehow focused in on you. Ignorance. absence of knowledge. In the absence of the knowledge of your real self. Dehavasana, you see, all of these desires that is driving us crazy are desires based on your presumption that you are this body mind. That's why you want to lose weight, have what this, that, because why? Your presumption you are this body mind. And this kind of ignorance is the root of profound suffering. You see, not knowing who you really are, you become identified with that which you are not, asmita ego. And then you fall into this abyss. And your whole lifetime is spent living on the basis of being that which you are not. So much more can be said about all of these things. But perhaps you will need to go somewhere from here and sit quietly and examine your life and see if you are living your life for which this human lifetime has been given. I used to always say an unexamined life is not even worth living. And a lot of times we're afraid to examine our life out of the fear that we will discover that the kind of life we live in ain't worth living. Hence the fear to get involved in radical self-evaluation. But you don't want to have to deal with that revelation. So you avoid this radical examination of your own life and go on pretending that you are doing something profound. It's nothing profound about your life. You read a few books. It's not very profound. So this is what I suppose the original celebration of the New Year was all about. It was to examine how you have lived during the past year and you see what's got to be fixed here about that. You see, I suppose that's how the holiday had its origin, you see. But I don't think it was purpose to figure out how I'm going to make more money this year than I made last year, and so forth and so on, as if that is urgent. Now, don't misunderstand me. Yes, you have to take care of all that stuff, but there's no urgency. That's left foot stuff. Swamiji Maharaj said, you do that with your left foot. You see? It doesn't take all of you to do that. So you must get serious or be made serious about what you will do with this human lifetime, because you ain't got all this time. I listened to the Kula meetings and so forth and so on, you see. And you all do your check-ins and so forth and so on, and you articulate your challenges, your struggles, and this and that, you see. And what you're still working on. And most of these breakdowns and procrastinations are the result of your presumption that you got more time. You got time. You don't have all this time. And you see, once you have become identified with this body, mind as being who and what you are, then you become full of all kinds of ambitions and goals and desires that by definition can't be fulfilled. Because now, and due to your identification with this body, you don't want to grow old. You're going to grow old. And you're going to get sick. You don't want to get sick, but you're going to get sick. And you're going to get feeble-minded. And you will get feebled in this body. And this body will drop. This thing is made to drop. You see? But you want to achieve physical immortality. You want this thing to last forever, and this thing is not going to last forever. You see? And nothing that you have done and are doing is going to stop that movement of time that will bring this thing to an end. Just look and see what time has done to your body now. Just, y'all get, you know, go look in the mirror in the washroom. Look in there. See, that's what time has done to you. Time has done that to you. Are you with me? And nothing that you are doing is stopping what time is up to, is it?
Yes,
and that's what you're trying to do. You're trying to defeat time. How you gonna do that? You try not to grow old. How'd that work for you? You try not to be sick. Okay, how's that work for you? And this is what you're doing with your life. You're trying to do something that is impossible. And if you don't go the natural route of decay, you see, then somebody gonna murder you. Actually, I'm sometimes surprised nobody will not murder some of you. Or an accident will wipe you out. Or you become so depressed and discouraged after countless failures to make Jagat obey your vasanas, you blow your damn brains out, suicide. Or you struggle out of ignorance until the last breath goes and then you die. That's not it. Maharaj used to say, Kala has everybody in its grip. Soami got his foot on, Soami got his hand around their throat, some sitting on, but Kala has got everybody. And he got you too. But you don't realize that you're in trouble because you don't have the knowledge by which the realization that you're in trouble is possible. Hmm? And for most people, they'll never have the knowledge of the process by which knowledge can be had. You all are, by grace, given the knowledge by which the knowledge can be had. But because of that veil of ignorance, that avarana, you say, it is not. You follow me? So I said what I had to say. What do you all have to say about it? No. Yes, beloved.
Okay. You speak of the real world. Oh. Okay, you speak of the real world and real God. And you say, you taught us that this world we're living in right now is an illusion and that we are gods. So if we are gods, why are we seeking that?
It's a good question. Okay. You're seeking it because you have not really realized it. You have been told that, but it is not your realization. And that seeking, beloved, doesn't end until it becomes your realization. It's the one of the phases that one goes through here. You all have read and studied the various shastras and the sutras, and intellectually you have understood, I'm only consciousness itself, I'm God for real. I mean, you have understood that, but that's not how you feel about yourself.
How
do
you know?
Huh? Because you don't act like it. You see, there's a story in the teaching tradition and that illustrates this contradiction. Because it's not new, and it has been addressed. And I'm not going to tell it in its entirety, but just enough for you to get the point, hopefully. And it's an ancient story, totally different contexts since time immemorial. But it's about a prince who was kidnapped. As a babe by a band of dacoits, thieves, and taken away, you see, and raised by these dacoits and these thieves, you see. And the king searched high and low, you see, for his missing son, but alas, could not find him. And as the years rolled by, you see, and finally, of course, even kings must die. And so the king on his deathbed, you see, still longing for the return of his son, the prince, who is his heir, instructed his minister, you see, that he must make a last effort to go find my son, the prince, you know, and bring him here, you see, so that he may have his inheritance from me. And so the minister went back again. Yeah, went many times, but he made one last time. After all, this was a dying king's request. You don't say no to that, you see. And he went through the kingdom again, looking high and low, and by grace, he found this prince now. Years have went by, obviously, the prince is no longer a baby and so forth, but he still had his birth.
birthmark, you see.
And this is how the minister recognized him. The birthmark was there, you see. And so he got this man out of the clutches of these day courts, you know what I mean? And grabbed him up and was telling them, you see, young man, you're not the one that they had told you you are. You're not a Descartes. You're not a thief. You are a prince, you see. And you must come with me, you see, back to the palace where your father is waiting for you to bequeath unto you all that he has to give you. He has a whole kingdom to give you. You need not live the life of a Descartes, you see. And the young prince, of course, tried to resist, but how do you resist the minister? He's standing there with army. You know what I mean? This is going to go down. You know, whether you like it or not, you're a prince. Let's go. See? And so, fast forward, and they travel back to the palace. And as they're coming into the palace, you see, you know, these palaces are huge. There's a hall, and there's all these people. You know what I mean? Nothing like the riffraff he's been hanging with. You see my point? And the prince comes in, and he sees a gold statue. And he asked the minister, he said, that gold? Yeah, it's gold, pure gold. He said, I'm going to steal that. I'm going to steal that. And the minister's telling him, no, you don't have to steal, it's yours. You don't have to steal no more. You're not a Descartes. You're not a thief. You know what I mean? He said, okay, but in his mind, he's still saying, the desire to steal still arose in him because he was being told something that was not his direct personal knowledge. It's like you know that such and such is wrong, but that don't stop the desire from still arising in you. Well, he was like that. And so he comes in, you see, and so the minister says, okay, prince, you know, you're a prince now, you know, you gotta stop all that, you know, maybe it was sagging, you know how that is. And he said, you can't be walking like that. Hey, you know, walk like a prince, man. You're a prince. He said, I don't know how to do it. He said, just imagine that you were a prince and start walking like one. And he said, okay. You know, imagine. He said, what a prince must walk. And he starts stepping like a prince, you know, like a king roll. And all the other people assembled there, filled in line, and got behind him. You know, he's walking now. You see what I'm doing? And you all know how the story ends. Happily ever after, his father got him, blessed him, gave him all of that. You see, the point of the story is that he had lived his life as a Descartes. He thought like a Descartes. He walked like a Descartes, and all of that. But he was a prince. Now, it's the same for us. You know, we're students of Sant, or whatever our spiritual traditions are that brought us together. And we have heard a lot of teaching, and we've been told, you are only pure consciousness itself. You are that which you are calling God. You are real God, not your concept of what God is. You are the real God, you see? You are the creator of what exists in the waking state experience. Nothing that is arising in this waking state experience exists without your being conscious of it. You are the context in which everything is arising, persisting, and disappearing. Tatwamasi. You're told that. But like the prince, you said, no, I'm a Descartes, you see. And you come into this kingdom of waking state consciousness, and you trying to get everything you can. You stealing shit all over the place. All of this is yours. What is there to, you know, steal? There's nothing to steal here. I see ya.
You follow me? That I got to give me some stuff, as much stuff as I can, otherwise I'm going to pay. All of this is yours. How can you be insecure knowing all this is yours? Are you with me? Yes. You can finish the analogy, can't you? It's like that. You have intellectual knowledge, but you don't have the real knowledge. Intellectual knowledge is not the knowledge that the saints are talking about. You see, there is a kind of knowledge that can only occur from being something, consciously being something. So what you have to do, you have to start acting like you are the very divine. Yes.
Book I'm reading. Mm-hmm. What would Jesus do? You may have read. I don't
know. What would Jesus do? It's the name of the book.
It's the name of the book.
I got it.
And the people, hold on, let me give you a little bit, if I can, of the story. You're in a white environment. A black man comes into this white environment, church, stands in front of the pulpit or whatever, and dies. And there was a big uproar because all of these white people are saying, what are we going to do, and what are we, you know. So the pastor decided to form a group, and the group was to answer the question, what would Jesus do? And by them all participating in the group, it was volunteer basis. Everyone measured everything in their life according to what they thought Jesus would want them to do. My question, when you do this kind of thing over and over and over again, after a while you become what I think you're saying we should become.
I'm not quite.
And act the way you say you don't act like it. So I'm saying,
yes,
is that the way?
Yes, it's sort of like it related to that. If Jesus is your istadavata, if Jesus and Christianity is your highest understanding of what a divine life consists of and how it should look, okay, then you act like Jesus. That's what it means to be a Christian.
Okay.
You follow me? If you're a Buddhist, then you act like the Buddha. If you're a Muslim, then you act like Muhammad. Whatever your istadavata is, you see, that should become your goal of how you try to conform your life and living. The problem in conforming, whether you're Christian, Muslim, or Buddhist, is your vasanas.
What?
Your vasanas, your desires. You don't have no control over them.
You see? I
don't. For instance, Jesus said, take no thought, right? If you think, it's just like acting. You see my point? It has the same outcome. Your thoughts, you see, you may imitate. There's a book by Thomas of Kempis, Imitation of Christ. That's an imitation, right? And we want to draw a little bit of a distinction here, right? Imitation is one thing, but hypocrisy is another thing altogether. Are you with me? So you may be a Christian hypocrite. You may act like it on the outside, but on the inside, you follow what I'm saying?
No, you don't feel that.
You don't even feel that compassion. You're just going through the motion. Are you with me?
Yeah.
That's all right too. That's where you at. Just know that's where you at, and don't get it twisted, and don't get confused. Otherwise, it's just vanity.
Yeah, but all our actions are taught. And so,
it depends on you. You see, it's you. You have to stay focused on you. One of the things you'll learn over time is that you don't have to worry about the judgment and the people in the world. That ain't your problem.
No, I don't.
And you don't have to worry about the soul, the divine part of your being, the Atma. You see? Because there ain't nothing wrong with that. Your problem, our problem, is your own mind. You need to work on your mind, and you need to purify your mind. Of all of those kinds of things that is causing the ignorance. Are you following me? Because at some point you see, you're not a Christian, and you're not a Buddhist, and you're not a Muslim. You're not even a human being in the conventional sense of the word. You're not this body.
Right.
You see, you go on through that process of nete, nete. You can't know what you are like an object because it's not an object. Mm-hmm. You follow me? What you can know is what you are not. But that which you are, you're not going to know that like you know this body. Mm-hmm. Are you with me?
Okay.
It's unknowable because it's not an object.
Okay. See?
So what we tend to do, beloved, we're trying to know the real self as if the self is some kind of an object.
Oh, okay.
This is not possible. Mm-hmm. But because you're ignorant, you're trying to see yourself with your eyes and hear yourself with your ears. How would you do that? Mm-hmm. It's the unseen seer.
Oh, okay. Hmm?
That dormancy. And that's what you got to know. Otherwise, you see, you just identify with a concept of yourself. I am a Christian. That's a concept you have of yourself. Or I'm a Buddhist. Or I'm a this. I'm a Radhasi. I'm a Satsangi. I'm a Vedantist. All of these are just concepts of self. That's not the self. It's a concept of the self. It's okay.
Does feeling have anything to do with it?
That's a very good question, too, you see. You're on a roll today. I know you don't want to stop, right? But you don't have to stop sooner or later. You see, beloved, we have these five senses through which we are having the experience of this world. The five senses of perception, they call it. This word perception is problematic, you see. Because while we may use that word when we're talking about gaining knowledge of the world through the sense of sight, because we perceive, we see. But there's something that precedes perception itself. And that is called a sense of something existing. Sant is the term used in the Eastern tradition. Sant. Because in the tradition we talk about that the substratum underlying the appearance of anything, they call that Sat-Chit-Ananda. So when you see a thing, what happens first, before you cognize and judge and label it, you sense that it exists. Something exists, and I look now, and I cognize it, label it, judge it, respond to it, interact with it. But first, before any of that, there is the sensing of sat. This sensing of the sat is deeper than your labor and what is sensed. I don't know if any of that makes sense to you. That's a cooler consideration. You know, right? You have to sit around and really ponder that. You see? You know that something exists. For instance, even with the ordinary senses, right? When I close my eyes and I touch something, I'm not seeing that thing, but I sense that there's something here. Are you with me? That's not a perception in the conventional use of that word,
okay.
Is it? I sense it. I smell some aroma. I don't see a spore. I sense it. Right? I don't see a sound. I sense it. Some noise back there. It's
someone else in the closet. I sense it, you follow me? That's deeper. That's deeper. That's the deep. And what you'll notice is that everything at its fundamental core, prior to your labeling it, your cognition, all of it exists. That existence is one. Like you have a sense that you exist, right? This also exists, right? This existence and your existence is one. Existence is not, don't have hearts. It is one. The existence of this thing we call a bottle is the same existence that you are having the experience of. You exist. You know you exist, right? Right?
Yeah.
You don't have to ask nobody. It is self-evident. You exist. That existence is the same as this existence. Now, I'm not doing any justice to this argument. But since you asked, I'm responding a little bit to it. In the hopes that it's just not an academic question, you know what I mean? And go in one ear and out the other ear. So when the mystics tell us, tap, twam, I see, that's what you are. This pure sat existence. A hum with no remainder. Not I am a woman. I am Nirvana Devi. No, no. Get rid of the woman, get rid of the Nirvana Devi. That's a name, that's a form. You are this pure I am. But the problem is, even when we're told that, you're not experiencing yourself as that. Because your life obviously proved you're not seeing yourself as aham. You follow me? There's no what we call sat-chakra. There's not the actual realization of it. It's a mental realization. That's good. Nothing wrong with that. At least from the wrong concept you had of yourself, you have a right concept now, that I'm only consciousness itself. That's the information. It's the right view of self, but that's not your experience of yourself. You experience yourself as Nirvana Devi. You see, I'm a woman. I'm black. You see, I'm this, I'm that. It's all right. It's a beginning. But that's not it. You see?
I want the it.
Well, act like it. So the thing is that you see, we have to start acting like, once you have become intellectually convinced beyond a shadow of doubt that you are only consciousness itself, then you must act like that. In the beginning, it's an act, like the day before, act like that. Start acting like that. You see? That's the spiritual process. Start acting like that. You see? But to be able even to act like that, you're going to have to do a lot of undoing in yourself. Because you've been acting like you are not consciousness, not just all of this lifetime, but many lifetimes before that. And that is deeply ingrained in you. You see? And that becomes your problem, you see. We leave satsang, or we leave a cooler group, or we close a good book that has reinforced in us the notion that I am only consciousness itself. By the time we close the book or leave the room or so forth and so on, you forget that. You forget that you're only consciousness yourself and you start acting like you're black again. Is that all right?
Right.
It's a bad idea.
I want to know how how to stay focused?
Well, you have to practice. See, this is called nididhyasana. This is the practice. You must practice that. It's like with meditation. You sit for meditation, your attention runs out, you bring it back. It runs out again, you bring it back. You got to train your mind. See, you don't have a trained mind. You have not trained your mind. So you can't have the results of a trained mind when your mind is untrained. Sadhana, spiritual practice, meditation is about training your mind. You see? But that's an ordeal. That's a tapasa. You see? And you want to avoid that. You want to read a book and then, you know, somehow have that transform and train your mind. You can't train your mind reading a book. That's not mind training. That's just getting some information. Are you with me?
Yeah.
Right? So you got to start with training your mind. You got to first even have some sense of what kind of mind you got, what state of mind you operate out. Because there are different states of mind depending upon the level of how well that mind has been trained. Are you with me?
Yeah, but how do you define that?
You look at it. You don't have to define it. You look at your mind. You see? It's your mind. It's immediate. Observe it. Instead of observing the world and people in the world trying to see their mind, see your mind. Look at your mind. Notice your mind. You follow me? It's a kind of inquiry. Are you with me? It's a part of the task of self-examination. You must examine your mind. It's like you know your body, right? Because you've examined your body. You know every part, how all of this look, and where the stretch marks are, and all of that. We know all of the secrets of this body, right? What's on it that is real, we know these in our real deep body. We know this to some degree. Okay, good. Now, get familiar with your mind. And look and see what kind of mind you are operating out of, because this is very important. The kind of mind and quality of mind that you are operating out of is going to dictate your whole experience, right? And there are different states of mind. We've gone over that in some of the cooler groups and so forth, so I'm not going to exhaust this here, you see. But there are certain kinds of states of mind that is guaranteed to keep you perennially stupid and ignorant. And that first state of mind is what we call kishita state of mind, the wandering mind, totally untrained. It's all over the place. The discursive mind, it's just all over the place. You can't concentrate, you can't reflect, you can't do nothing. It's just all over the place. The monkey mind, just jumping here to there, jumping here to there. That kind of mind, you see, is incapable of having knowledge. Period. It has to be trained. You see? And one of the things that we experience when you sit and meditate, you come in direct contact with the quality of your mind. You can't keep your mind out of the past or out of the future at all. It's not trained to be present. You have not trained it. You're trying to read a book on now. You can read the now the rest of your damn life and you will never be in the now. Books can't get you there. Reading books about meditation is not meditation. And it will not produce the outcome. Listening to these talks about meditation, this ain't no meditation. Are you with me? It's talk. You gotta train. You got to train. But you won't be moved to train your mind if you never looked at your mind and see that you're not even sane. First, you got to get sane. You follow me?
Yeah.
You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And we can go on and on like that. But you have to see which of these states of mind, these problematic states of mind, that you are fundamentally operating out of, you see? It's five. Well, for most of us, it's just three that we tend to operate on. The other two is what we want to get to.
Okay.
With me? So you have this kishita, this wandering, this curse all over the place, you see. Then you have this mudda, fantasy. It's always fantasy. You're just lost in fantasy. Always pondering something about, it's hypothetical thinking. Boy, if I get this, if I win this, then my life is going to be this. You understand? It's the kind of mind that is deluded, full of delusion mm-hmm. about everything, including yourself. Mudda, infatuated. And much more can be said about it, but you have a cooler group. Probably I've mentioned it in that group. I don't even know what group you're in anymore, but whatever it is, check back with them. I'm sure I must have touched upon it. And if I that way do justice to this here, I'm just glossing this now. You see. And then vikshipta, you see, distracted, easily distracted, can't concentrate. Man, you have no ability to concentrate, no samadhana, no ability to do anything with one point of attention at all. That kind of mind, those kinds of mind states and quality of mind. That's got to be overcome. You can't even get into the process, you see. We talked about that fourth kind of knowledge that I mentioned, besides knowledge of self, knowledge of the world, knowledge of real God. Then you need to have knowledge of real spiritual practice and real sadhana, and the real means by which you can have those prior three forms of knowledge, right? That's sadhana. This is real sadhana that I'm talking to you about here. You got to get your mind clean. Purified, straight, trained. And it starts with very basic things, the nyamas, the niyamas, and so forth and so on. You see, you got to get back to the basics. A mind full of anger, lust, greed, attachment, that mind can't, by definition, have knowledge. Because it won't have any of the requirements. You must be able to concentrate, what we call ekagraha. Ekagraha, the ability to concentrate. Fix your mind. You gotta have that. Then ultimately, the mind has to be made perfectly still. Nirodha, mananasya, manalaya. It's required. Make sense to you, brother? So our work is on the mind. Don't worry about this world and the people and fixing it. Don't get into all of that. That's none of your damn business. That's Ishvara business. Are you with me?
Yes.
The world that you're trying to fix is your some creation. That's your thing. It's all messed up because it's made out of your mind state. Are you with me?
Yes.
Work on your mind. Don't even work on your soul. Your soul don't need no work on it. Working on my soul. What kind of nonsense is this? Soul, Atma, don't need no work on it. Your mind. So you have to study, you have to reflect, you have to inquire, you have to do all these things. You see? But to do those things, you have to sacrifice. You're going to have to give up something, and you don't want to do that. There's other shit more important to you. Yes, it is. You said no, but it is. You see my point? That's just the truth. We have to be straight here.
Straight up.
You follow what I'm saying? I'm not singling you out. It's not just true of you. It's true of a lot of people sitting up in here. You're too busy with a lot of other shit that is more urgent for you. Knowledge is not your urgency. And that's the bottom line. Having the knowledge is not urgent for you. What is urgent for you is the fulfillment of more of your lokavasana, status, power, wealth, socialization, friends, bills, paying my bill, doing this. You say no, but you're here. But you're right.
And that's the truth.
But see, we don't want to admit these things. We don't want to admit these things because it contradicts our image that we want other people to have of us.
We want to be perceived as being all this kind of spiritual person and all of that. See, that's more of our sinners. That's more local gossip. Because you want them to respect you, to praise you, to see that you, I'm not in like, I'm a serious person. I'm committed. I'm devoted. None of that is true. None of that is true. But it's got to get to. So this was, you know, when Jesus rolled up there in the temple with all them Pharisees, you know what I mean? That's what he was roaring that thumb up in there. Said, you got to get up out of here, man. You see? That's how that goes. You see? And I'm not trying to be mean here or anything like that. Are you with me?
Take it that way.
Yeah. But see, those are the games we got to stop playing with ourselves. And then you got to get down to business here. Why? Time.
Right.
That is on its way out of here. It almost went out years ago. Is that not right? You had that stroke, right? Yeah. Then that straightened you up? That was a stroke of grace.
Yeah.
Now what have you done with that grace? Mm-hmm. Now what have you done with that grace of that stroke that put you in that wheelchair, took your speech from you? Mm-hmm. Father, in that state, you promised God, if God, if you ever give me my health back and my speech back, I'm going to change. And then you forgot.
No, I didn't.
Yes, you did. You forgot. You forgot. Then we all have done something like that. If you get me off these drugs, if you don't let the police catch me. Lord, I'm going to. So you're no different from all of us. We all have done these things. Yes, you see my point?
Yes, sir.
We all have done it. You see? Kabir Sahib said that it started in the womb. He said when you was in your mother's womb, going through all that suffering, all that hell, you promised God if you only let me out of this womb, I will, you know, worship you for all the rest of my life. And then he let you out, and immediately you forgot about him and start just wasting your time in childish play, you see, and so forth and so on. It's a promise we made in the womb. It's a promise we never keep. And that's just the real deal, beloved.
Thank you.
But a time is coming. Time is coming. We'll say more about that later. Let's give somebody else a chance to say something. Yes, but not.
Hello?
Yes, but not.
What I don't understand about Satma is, like Master Kripal said, that in order to still the mind, you know, control the mind as you're talking about, you need to listen to the sound.
Mm-hmm.
And then he said, in, you know, in his books and his talks, that the sound, the nam, the light and sound, are given to you at the time of initiation. So when I was initiated, that never happened.
Mm.
But I didn't want to, you know, that was 40 years ago, and I didn't want to make waves.
Sure.
So I thought, well, I'll just do the meditation, which, you know, I've kept, he said, if you love me, you keep my commandments, which I've pretty well done. So it's been 40 years, and that promise has never been fulfilled to any degree whatsoever. When I first got initiated, I read a story where he talked about a Mohammedan professor who prayed more than what was required. And he said, why are you praying more than what's required? And he said, well, I know what the law is, but I do more to earn his will and pleasure. And so I thought, that's how I'm going to live my life. So I found a work situation when I was 23 where I didn't have to commute to work. And I lived on a property where I you know, could focus on meditation. So I arranged my schedule where I would work 3 days a week, and this was a time when the mind was out of whack, really. Mm-hmm. So I figured the only way that I can get a hold of this is to devote as much time as I could. So I had a job that was where I was working 3 days a week, and then 4 days a week I tried to meditate, you know, as much as I could. Mm-hmm. And I kept that schedule for 20 years until I had to get a real job and start preparing for, you know. So, you know, I've kind of tried a little bit, so I don't understand. Can you tell me why he's never kept that promise?
Mm-hmm. I can't tell you exactly why Kirpo Singh never kept that promise, obviously. And I can only speak to some of the shared teachings that the different Sant Math Gurus, Radha Swami Gurus, you see, have made. And some, of course, talk about the fact that when you initiate it on the spot, that something happens in that moment. You see light, or you hear shudder, and so forth and so on. And what you have to understand, beloved, is that a lot of times these things are said for the sake of creating followers. If you research, you have to go back into the history of Sant and travel backwards to the time of Swamiji Maharaj, right? The founding guru, you see? Not so much of the Radha Swami movement, because Swamiji Maharaj founded Sant Math. Huzur Maharaj Sadegram started Radha Swami Math. So Radha Swami Math is not something that Swamiji himself taught. Swamiji taught pure Sant Math. And in pure Sant Math, there's never this kind of misleading taking place. Now, I am not, of course, accusing Kirpal Singh of misleading you, but what I am doing is drawing the distinction between what Kirpal Singh told you and what Swamiji Maharaj said. And I can even add to that what Huzur Maharaj Charan Singh Ji said, you see. Like you, I had the opportunity of being initiated by my master in the flesh, in a room, not much bigger than this, you see, with no intermediary. There was no, what do you call them, representative involved in the process. It was Maharaji sitting, and a handful of us sitting there, you see. And Maharaji initiates you. I can tell you was very different from Kirpal Singh, Darshan Singh, or Jinder Singh, and that whole line. Very different. And that line they talk about Jyoti meditation, you see. Now some of these gurus, particularly Thakkar Singh, who was another breakaway guru, and came to Chicago, and Thakkar Singh would set people down, and then he would put his hand on the eyeballs, and then they would see light. Anybody would see light if you do that, are you with me? Or you'll be taught to hold your eyes tight, and that would generate light. But none of that is the process, you see. This light and this sound never occurs unless you have developed the requisite level of concentration. That's the truth. You see, it is not something that is given automatically. It's not shaktipat. Are you with me? It's not like that. What is given is the means by which you should be able to now train your mind and cultivate that concentration, and you will see the light. You see? Provided the concentration is there. Nobody can give you a concentrated mind. Mm-hmm. That can't happen. And anybody that tells you that is pulling your leg. You follow me? This is Sant Math. And so what has happened over the courses of these couple hundred years since the advent of Swamiji Maharaj that the tradition that came out of Agra is now spreaded all over the place, and you have some 30 or 40 gurus or so, all claiming to teach what Swamiji taught. But what they're teaching is Radha Swami Mata, and that is created by Saligram. And even Saligram's instructions are very different. Are you with me? So there's a lot of things that many people who come to Sant Mata, they don't know anything about Sant Mata. You see? What they have is a kind of earlier version that came when the teachings came over to America, that is mostly a rewriting of Christianity and stuff like that. It's an adaptation into our culture. But in India, you see, there are still those gurus whose parampuras come out of Sant Mata, because even Swamiji Maharaji come out of the Tulsi Sahib tradition. You see, Tulsi Sahib, you've heard of Tulsi Sahib of Hathras, right? That's the lineage that Swamiji mother and father were there, you see? And in that lineage of Sant Mata, it's the same thing. There is no Shaktipat, but it is giving you the means by which you can train your mind, get it concentrated so that you can see the light and hear the sound. And you will see the light, you see. Now, what will happen, and what probably did happen for you, beloved, even with Kripal Singh Ji Maharaj, you see, initiation, you were shown how to listen for the Shabad. You may not have heard that Shabad that pulls, you see, that transport, that's true. But you would automatically have heard one of the lesser Shabad, one of the 10 preliminary sounds. Everybody hears that. You see? Now, with that, you practice to develop your concentration. But a lot of us, perhaps, beloved, were naive when we came through the door. We figured that, you know, I got this initiation, I'm going to sit here, and I'm going to catch the bell sound and so forth. No, that's not going to happen. That's not going to happen, because the mind has to be made pure. And even in the Sant Mata literature that you study, it says over and over again, an impure mind cannot catch the Shabad. It tells you that clearly. It's not going to happen. An unconsecrated mind is not going to catch Shabad, and it's not going to see radiant anything. Right? So on one hand, the truth is buried there, you see, but it's covered with a lot of other stuff. But it's there. It's there. So it's listening with a purified mind and at the eye center. I mean, there's some things that are technical about these practice within the context of the Sant Mata tradition. You must be able to sit at the eye center. You see, you must be able to locate your attention at the eye center, and there you do Simran and you do Bhajan. Now, if you've been doing your Simran and Bhajan outside the eye center, nothing's going to happen with that. You follow me? It has to be done in the eye center. So that's very important. Also, the Radha Swami or the Sant Mata where lifestyle has to be there as well. You see? So in India, for instance, where Sant Mata was never divorced from the teachings in the Upanishad and so forth and so on. That's a westernized version of Sant Mata. In traditional Sant Mata, Sant Mata is not contradicting or saying anything different than in the Upanishads and in the other six systems in India. It's all grounded in the same thing. There must be yamas, there must be niyamas. You got to do that, you see? That has to happen. There must be socha. You must purify your mind of anger, lust, greed, attachment. You must develop a mind that is not mudda, not full of fantasies and so forth and so on. That work has to be done. And there's no getting around that, you see. But those of us in the West, because we were so steeped in this Christian thing, that we thought, well, you know, the guru's going to do all of this, he's going to touch me on the head and voila, no. That's not how that goes. You see my point? And we therefore arrogate to ourselves a kind of quality of development, a level of development that in reality we don't have. And so then we're disappointed, we're discouraged. Fine, I understand all of that, you see. But the reality of Sodom is such that it doesn't happen like that, you see. Now, you also had a chance to live through the ministry of Darshan Singh Ji Maharaj, is that correct?
Yeah.
And you said in on his initiations as well, right?
You never
said in on Darshan Singh Ji Maharaj. Okay. And his initiation was a little less bombastic and full of those kind of promises. Now, of course, Rajinder Singh Ji Maharaj, and again, I'm careful to say anything about this because I don't like talking about this, you know, because, you know, I don't want to be misunderstood or in any way say anything to diminish the voice. It can be construed as disrespect. But even in Rajinder Singh Ji Maharaj, who's carrying on that particular line, there's the same thing now. Jyoti meditation, like close your eyes and see some light. No. That's not how it goes. You see? That's lowering the teachings. Now, to say something in their defenses, what happens oftentimes, most teachers will start with the top, and then they'll slowly reduce them, to a level where people can respond. And unfortunately, most people can only respond at the level of superstition, religion. So spirituality gets reduced to religion, and then people can embrace it. You know what I mean? But it's watered down. It becomes very watered down. And so it gives you the illusion that you can just, you know, walk through the door, you know what I mean, and repeat a mantra, and you should be enlightened by the end of the week. And it doesn't work like that. In the tradition, in fact, it was expected that 12 years minimally is required, you see, of concentrated meditation, you see. The great master, Soami Singh Ji Maharaj, used to always say that even if you can sit your body down motionlessly, hold it still for 3 hours, Jagat Singh Ji Maharaj said the same thing, your attention will come to this eye center. But you can't do that. You see my point? And so it's a lot of frustrated satsangis. I know. A lot of frustrated satsangis. And they're frustrated and they are disappointed in their spiritual progress because they do not understand. You see, there hasn't been any guru mukhs here, you see? And there must be a guru mukh, you see? So, in these sanghas, you know, there's never any very intimate conversation. Nobody talks about it, it's all quiet. Mm-hmm. They don't say anything about it. There's no kula process in place, you know? There's no real energy. It's just quoting scriptures. As if quoting scriptures is going to transform somebody. And those radical statements are buried in the books. Right? Now, to Babaji Maharaj credit, he's now teaching. Stop reading all these books on this old Sant Mat version 1. That's Sant Mat 1.0. Stop all that. You know what I mean? Because it just created a lot of fantasy in your mind. See, you had a lot of fantasy about it, you see, but you fantasize about it. We come from that age, right? We're from that age, that time, you know? When everybody was finding a guru to get enlightened, you know what I mean? That's where we came from that time, you and I. For many of them, it never happened. They moved to California and continuing their search. But this is grace, you see.
might be a very good thing. Mm-hmm. Those years, those 40 years are not years wasted at all. Now you know. You got to really do the real deal. It's a real deal here. Mm-hmm. And all the basic stuff got to get done. Mm-hmm. You can't run away from the world. You see, you got to deal with this thing. Mm-hmm. You got to deal with this thing. So sitting in your closet, on one of those days you were able to set aside to meditate and stuff like that, you know, not much different than what a yogi does up in a cave somewhere. But a lot of those swamis, those yogis in a cave, they can't concentrate either. Because they're thinking about the world, they're thinking about this, they're thinking about that, they're thinking about, you know, where I'm big up on some food somewhere. All kinds of things are in the mind. But the mind got to be dealt with, beloved. So this is just a little bit. You and I, of course, will have to have that kind of privacy. You know what I mean? Because there's so much to share with you relative to that. And I did have a chance to hear the argument of Kapal Singh Ji Maharaj a lot, and I used to come to the satsang. You know, heard all of that. Mm-hmm. Very interesting. Mm-hmm. But I'm sure you know by now that you're not the only one that felt they got cheated. I think you know that. Mm-hmm. And so what can I do? But you might as well make the best use of it. You can't get those 40 years back, I know that. That's gone, man, so they ain't coming back, you see. But maybe now you're at that time in your life now where you're ready for the real deal, you know. You know the real deal. But I can only tell you what I've said thus far. There is nothing magic about this here. You know, nobody gives you a concentrated mind. Nobody tap you on the head and suddenly your mind become concentrated. That shit don't happen in the real world. Sadhana is required of everyone. You've got to do the work. Hmm? And there's no way around that. You see. I have a friend now, two of them, three of them, 4 minutes, 5 minutes. You see. And been initiated years, you see what I'm saying? They still caught up in this mythology about the guru and Sant, the Sant mythology, I call it, you see. And they're chasing this and they're chasing that and they're looking for highly developed souls to touch them on the head so they don't have to do no meditation and so forth and so on. I know that whole crowd, you know what I mean? The whole Isha crowd, which is why I pulled all of these boys, you know what I mean? Been around. Same thing. You know what I mean? Looking for magic. There is no magic. You see? I knew Satsangi, they went to India, you see my point? And they chased down Maharaji to get his darshan. I knew one guy that was so bold, so arrogant, you see, tracked down Maharaji, found out where Maharaji was staying that night, and went and knocked on the damn door. At least we hid behind the cars. You know? Went and knocked on the door, rang the bell, and went in, you see? Because he said, man, if I can give me some real up-close darshan, I'll be able to see the radio for a lot. I got him some real up-close darshan. You see my point? 2 years later, he was chasing women all over the place. He had stopped meditating, didn't do no good. You see my point? It wasn't right inside. When it's right inside, just a glimpse of the matter. It's about what's inside. It's where you are inside. And see, you were meditating for an experience, and I'm going to end it with that, and then you and I can talk as we always do. See, when you're meditating for experiences, that's because you don't read too much spiritual shit. And your head is full of too much fantasy. You're meditating for spiritual experiences. I want to see some light. I want to hear some sound. I want to see some Jesus. I want to see Kabul. You know, you want some spiritual experience. I can tell you, frankly, those who meditate for spiritual experiences will have no spiritual experience. They will fail because they're meditating for the wrong reason. Meditate to train your mind. That's why you meditate. Not all these damn experiences, your fantasy. I want to be able to read other people's mind. You're meditating for cities, supernatural powers. You're meditating for bullshit, and that's what you get at the end of that meditation. You get bullshit. You don't get it like that. And even if by chance, as a result of the concentration of the mind and some inner experiences arise, discount that, because all experiences, however profound they are transient and permanent. They come, they go. This ain't about getting no inner experiences. Babaji Maharaj allegedly complained to Swamiji, his guru, about not making progress. I don't know that you know that story, Brian Saeed. Elijah Saab knows it. Tell it to him later. And he meditated for years and never had no experiences. And all these other satsangis have an experience. You know, oh man, I was up in Sahans Dunkawa and I saw this and I saw that. You know, and Baba Jemo saying ain't seeing jack. You know what I mean? And you know, and he's getting jealous. Because, you know, he's a sadhu. You know, Baba Jemo Singh was a celibate. You know? Celibate. Brahmachari. Sadhu. You know what I mean? He did more than was required because it's a household path. He said, no. I'm going to go brahmachari. You see my point? Sorrow. And he meditated. You know? Meditated. Did great sadhana. You see? Even when he was in the army, he was put his rifle beneath through his legs and sit on a battlefield. This man was serious about it. But he was making no inner progress at all. No inner experience. No lights, no nothing. And out of frustration, he wrote to the guru. And the guru told him, no, I'm taking you up blindfolded, so that you don't get distracted. See, sometimes it's the grace of the master to not give you any inner experiences because you get lost in that shit. Yeah. People get lost in just shit they read. They ain't even had no spirit. I mean, you know, they open these books, they read this, and they lost. Whoa, I got a city. Book one, is this a city? Is this a real experience? No, you just read a book, you had a dream, you ate too much. You ain't had no damn spiritual experience. You see my follow what I'm saying? It's a grace in some sense. Because it don't get you off track. You see? Point I'm making though, you meditate to train this mind. That's why you meditate, and not for these experiences. And most people that come to a spiritual path and even take to meditate, they're looking for some damn experience to enhance them in the world, basically, right? Fundamentally. They want some kind of supernatural power. They want something, you see my point? Extraordinary. They want something that can elevate their status, you know, reinforce their false concept of their own spirituality, you know what I mean?
That's not what I'm talking about.
I know that's not what you're talking about. I wasn't talking to you.
You're told that you need the sound current to still the mind.
True. So, you do need the sound, but they tell you first.
That's an experience.
But they tell you first you need to purify the mind to catch the sound current.
No, they don't.
No, that's what they tell you.
Well, that's not what I'm talking about.
Then that's probably not what you were told. That's why I said I'd send you back to Swamiji. And that way you can, because I don't want to argue the points that were emphasized by these different mystics, you know. But since they all accept Swamiji, you know what I mean? Then I think I can safely refer you back. But it tells you over and over again that will I'm not gonna spell that. You make an effort to understand this stuff. The necessity for the purity of the mind, beloved, is standard teaching that runs through all traditions. Care what they are, Vedanta, Buddhist, doesn't matter. It is there. You might also want to read the Radha Upanishad. And the Radha Upanishad, which is the Upanishad that talks about Shavyoga. That's the definitive work on Shavyoga. Go read the Radha Bindu Upanishad. And they will tell you the same thing. I know that Maharaji told us, clear. You ain't gonna hear no sound that pulls, that transports you, unless the mind is purified. It has to get purified. You see? And purification means free from all of these kleshas. In Buddhism, we call them kleshas, turbulence, disturbances in the mind. And what are those disturbances? Calm, desire. You see? When the mind is full of desires, it's not calm, it's turbulent. It can't concentrate. And without concentration, how would you get a shovel? I mean, how is this possible? That's not possible. That's not even reasonable to expect that. And where there is this turbulence caused by desire, calm, the vasanas, you see? And when those desires are not fulfilled, that's going to be anger. That's another klesha. Now, it's anger in the mind. So, you know all these things. Kam, krodha, lobha, modha, you see, ahankara, madha, jealousy, so forth and so on, ill will. The Buddha, chukha, akarya, and Vedanta, you see my point? Abhinavagupta and Shavaism, it doesn't matter where you look in any tradition. Jesus, Mohammed, all of them taught the same thing. This mind must be purified. I'm glad you brought that up because budging is necessary. It's part of our practice offered here at the House of Rock every report. But you have to understand that. I hope you all understand that.
Yes, sir.
Something else to say about it, beloved? That was excellent. That was a real treat. I'm glad I came today. You know, I was thinking, man, I'm going to be wasting my time. So glad that you are here and that you speak of something that is a part of the reality of a spiritual aspirant life. You know what I mean? Because you were serious. I know that I've known you over the years. Not a frivolous brother. You see my point? He's sincere. But even sincerity don't trump the prerequisites. It's good to be sincere. They don't trump what it requires. It must be purification of mind. Absolutely. I'm simply going to another extreme here by simply saying what you hear and see is it's not the point. But this hearing of the Shabbat is a means of quieting the mind, as you rightly said, because the mind must be quieted. In the Vedanta tradition, they call that quieting of the mind, mananasa.
There is a goal that we aim for in the practice of meditation. We have called it in the one of the tradition, Samma Sanyasa Sankappa. Samma Sanyasa Sankappa. What that really means is that when you're meditating, you see, and you're dealing with the mind, first you'll notice that the mind is nothing but a flow of clusters of thoughts. That's the mind. It's just a stream of thoughts in clusters moving through consciousness. And some of the clusters of thoughts streaming through consciousness are more dangerous than others. Now, the ones that we are calling vasanas, those are the dangerous clusters of thoughts because they are the ones that generate desires. For instance, you see something and you will think about it. It will run through consciousness and it will disappear, no problem. You see? It's like, to give you an example of a child. So you'll see a little boy, 3 or 4 years old, and a woman will walk past him. He would look, he would see her, and go back playing with his toy. The scene of the woman is gone. Now, my sailors see a girl. You're gonna follow her as far as you see the difference? That's a vasana. It's a desire, man. That's a fine day, man. Man, the divine take off, man. I wish I could run. That's the difference. The same object was seen, thoughts generated, but it wasn't a sankappa. So these, and sannyasa, you all know what sannyas means, right? Sannyas is when you move to that stage of life where you're through with the world, you all know all about that, right? And sannyas had a deeper meaning than simply that stage of life, that ashrama, where you enter into it, and now you're done with the world, and you go into the forest, and you devote the rest of your life to the spiritual pursuit and so forth. That's the traditional understanding of sannyas, you see? First was brahmachari, you all know all anything, you move through these stages. That's an outer form of sannyas, an external practice of sannyasa. But the deeper practice of sannyas is the renunciation of your thoughts that are the basis of desire. That's sannyasa. So, as you are witnessing your mind and the flow of thoughts going through consciousness, and when one of those clusters of thoughts arise, you see, that is sankalpa, you renounce it. You renounce it. Those thoughts that are streaming through consciousness that do not make up a vasana, you let flow through. It's no problem. And just notice yourself, if you really want to be serious about this mind training and so forth, just watch your mind, if you can. And some of you can't even watch your mind. But watch your mind throughout the day. Just watch it. Stand back, creep that gap. Watch your mind. Watch the kind of thoughts that arise in your mind. And notice that. And you will see there will be thoughts that come up in your mind. That's a nice car, you know what I mean? And then that's it. Then there's the thought that arrives in your mind, that's a nice car, man, I'm gonna get me one of them. Wonder how much that costs, you see? I wonder if I could borrow $10,000. You gotta have one of them. That's a BMW. You know BMW makes a good car. You know what I mean? Yeah, you guys know how to, you see what I'm saying? And you walk. Are you with me?
Yes. But if you remain in that witness,
stand up.
The witness is watching all that go by.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, isn't really, you could say almost the supreme practice is to remain as that witness?
Yes, that is it. That's what you're trying to get to abide as that sakshi, the witnessing consciousness of the thought constructs and clusters moving through consciousness.
So in that sense, it doesn't really matter if you're taken away as long as the witness is maintained through being taken away.
No, no. If you're taken away, you lose the witness position.
Okay, right, right.
You see my point by definition.
But if you get involved in the car, you're watching all the strategies to get it, the witness is maintained through all of those.
Yes, you get. If you don't get identified with the thought pattern, see, this is what happens. Because when you go away from the witnessing state, what has happened is you become identified with the thought.
So identification is losing the witness position.
Identification is loss of the witnessing
position,
by definition. And that's where a lot of us are. You see, we're identified with our mind. That's why I said identification with the body-mind. You see my point? And of those two, sometimes our identifications go back and forth, but you will find, if you observe your own self, that a lot of your time, or a lot of your sense of self is based on your identification with your mind. So let's say emotions, for instance, which are a different kind of clusters of thoughts moving through consciousness, right? And they move through consciousness, right? And then there's a cluster of thoughts that we call anger has arisen. Then you say, I'm angry. You follow what I'm saying? That means that the witnessing state is gone, right? And you become the anger. Now I'm angry, I gotta do something. You see, there's these sankalpas, beloved, to say a little bit more about it, these vasanas. Do everybody know what vasanas are? Because I use this language. If you don't, okay, study. Stop studying some shit. Vasanas themselves, from a functional point of view, can be categorized into two groups or two classes. One is what we call kata vasanas. Kata vasana. Kata means doer. There's a part of you that feel you are the doer. There's a part of you that feel like I gotta do something. You know what I mean? It's looking for something to do. That's karta vasana, the desire to do, to be the doer. I gotta do something. And then there are what we call the kama, K-A-M-A, not karma, K-A-M-A. The desire for sensual gratification, pleasurization, kama vasana. Now they work together, you see? So when there is a sankalpa moving through consciousness, that is a vasana cluster of the kama category, you see? Because suddenly, you see, you just find a thought rises up in your mind, I'm bored. I got to go do something to make myself feel better. You see my point? So that thought arises. Now, that's the kama vasana. Then following on its heel will be the karta vasana. What can I do to make myself feel better? I need to feel better now. What should I do? I gotta go do something. I gotta go eat something, go to church, let me call somebody, let me do something to satisfy this desire. Are you with me? Not a particularly good example, but you asked the following argument. That's karta vasana, kama vasana. And they move through consciousness. And those are the ones you gotta catch. Now just notice throughout the day, you'll find that when you fall into boredom, which is a form of dukkha. See, we think dukkha is just when somebody shoots you. Or steal your money. But there's many forms of God. You see? Boredom is one of them. fact, boredom is one of the most telltale forms of dukkha experienced by the ego-bound person. They have a lot of boredom. They get bored. You see, that's dukkha. But boredom don't feel good. Now, kartavasana, the desire to do something. I do something. I'm going to turn this TV on. Man, you won't look at it. Just turn the damn thing on. Just don't listen in the background. You know what I mean? That's what I'm saying. Now, let me eat something. You understand what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
And you just stand back and watch the mind, which itself is nothing but a process whereby clusters of thoughts are moving through consciousness. That itself requires a certain amount of training, doesn't it? Mm-hmm. Does it? Now remember, the kshipta state of mind can't do that because it's all over the place. You know what I mean? The mudha state of training of the mind can't accomplish it. The vichitta state of and quality can accomplish it. It must be ekagraha. You must be able to concentrate to even witness the mind. How would you witness the mind, the flow of thoughts, if you can't concentrate? How is that possible? You can't fantasize that you're in the witnessing consciousness. You don't get there through fantasizing, you don't get there through wishful thinking. You must be able to concentrate. You must be able to disidentify. It's a whole thing that is required. There must even be some avika. There must be some varajya, you see, in place already. Must be a certain amount of that. Otherwise you can't stand back. And see. Yes, beloved. Yes.
Okay. Bhagwan, like that flow of thoughts. Let me just Spanish.
Let him go ahead, Carlton. She's going to suffer if you
don't. No,
let that out, baby.
Like Bhagwan. Okay, yes, so beloved. That flow of thoughts. Those are like, past memories?
This could be all kinds of things, you see, because as you watch the mind, oftentimes those clusters, there is a memory cluster where you're way in the past somewhere.
Right.
And then there's an imagination. Sankappa, the word sankappa means imagination.
Mm-hmm.
It's just your imagination running wild. All over the place. Because you imagine that by getting this, I'll be happy. That's an imagination. You don't even know. You can't know because you ain't got it yet.
Right.
You imagine it will make you happy. Are you with me? Mm-hmm. So that imagination can go in the past, the future, and that's really where it's operating. You're constantly imagining. And the world you live in is also made out of that same imagination.
And then that's what we define as thinking.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Go ahead, on.
Yes.
Isn't that interesting?
That is thinking. Yes. It's just thinking, but it's thinking. Yeah. It's just the movement of clusters of thought running through consciousness.
Because I know that Vasta on the sound and music. You know, it'll take me back to when I was younger and dancing and that whole little thing,
Sure. That's how the mind works. The mind works by association. Right. And this is why, for instance, when we're initiated, the masters tell us, when you do your meditation, try to do it at the same time, same spot, so that an association is made.
Okay.
Because this process of mind, and now we all know what I mean by that. It's by association. See, it's some people that you associate with, the moment you get around them, you feel like eating you some barbecue. Right? Right?
Mm-hmm.
There's some people you associate, and the moment you see them, you just, you're ready to fight.
Right.
You see?
Association.
And so the mystic says that, okay, one of the things you got to do, if you are serious about it, you got to change your associations. You see, sangha. The word sangha means attachment. In the sense of association to the point of attachment. Satsangha means good association. See, there are negative associations and there's positive association. There's satsanga, and then there's sangha, or what we call here kusanga. Right? And you need satsanga. You see? Mm-hmm. In fact, in the tradition, they said the best thing that you a person on the path can do to improve their chances of succeeding with making right use of this life is to keep the company of spiritual people. You see? Preferably the guru. They had guru coolers back in the day. You see? And you kept the company of the guru. Satsanga. If you didn't have access to the external company of the guru, you kept the internal company of the guru, satsanga. That is called dhyana. You see? Feeling contemplation on the bodily form of the guru. Some tradition we call it istaguru bhakti yoga. You're keeping the company. If you can't do that dhyana, then the presence. Always feel to be in the presence. You see? And that's making a good use of this capacity for some kind of imagination, right? Yes, beloved. But do we go back to Brian's house?
I'm really interested in that discussion, and the question is, is this an aspect of ego that you're talking about? Say, for example, the thoughts that arise in awareness, do they have their fundamental basis and origin in thoughts that are related to survival, pursuit of happiness, and are therefore stored at a subconscious level? And actually, when you activate this constellation that you call, it's an opportunity to really view what you might have an opportunity to break up. But in thinking about its origin, it seems as though that just relates right back to ego processes.
Absolutely, beloved. A good insight. Because this is how the ego maintains itself. You see, once the identification with the body-mind has occurred, right, which is the fundamental mechanism that gives rise to the ego, because the ego, by definition, is identification of self with not-self. And usually, the identification of not-self means this body-mind. But when that initial, primary identification takes place, now, that whole desire thing goes. You see, because if you look at the different types of desires, back in the ABD that you all studied, it talks about loka-vasanas, it talks about deha-vasanas, and all these different types. All of those desires comes back to this identification with the body-mind. It also produces an instantly what we call mamakara. Now, though everything is here, some things here are mine, and some things are not mine. You follow me? This is mamakara. You see? So the ego start acquiring things. And every time it acquires something, its sense of self gets expanded. You see? So it get a house, my house. Now that my, that had its origin with just this body, gets expanded. And your relationship, my wife, my husband, my kid, now that expands that ego more. You see my point? So the ego gets expanded through this mamakara, this acquisition of material things and relationship is the means by which the ego expands itself. and become somebody, you see, because it's trying to become somebody, you see. So we get a car, you know what I mean? Now, if I give me a Rolls Royce,
yeah,
I'm expanded, right? Or I give me a mansion, I'm expanded, right? You see, these are ways of expanding. So, Dayo Sab, your insight is on point. Now, here's the problem. Oh, y'all are interested today. When we talk about these vasanas, there are different degrees of intensity of vasanas. The ones you're talking about, beloved, that were beneath the threshold of your conscious mind, we call those prasupta vasanas. They are dormant. You don't even know you got them until the circumstance and situation arises by which they have a chance to get fulfilled. Then them bastards come running out. You see my point? You never had a chance. You know what I mean? The conditions were not there to accommodate the fulfillment of that desire, that vasana. So that vasana is prasupta dormant. You don't even know you got it. At all. You didn't know that you were a racist, or you didn't know that you were a philanderer. You didn't know you was a liar. You didn't know none of these things until the conditions arose. You didn't know that you were dishonest. Until a situation arose where you found that $500 that somebody had dropped. And they answered, did you see my money? No. You didn't know you were dishonest. You didn't know you was a liar. Because the condition, before then, you think, I don't lie, I'm honest. No. This is how it goes. That's prasupta vasana. You see? You didn't know that. And there's all kinds of examples we can give, but you all get my point? Mm-hmm. Even you find a shock to see how you behave in that moment when one of those prasupta vasana surfaces. You thought you were nonviolent until your neighbor slapped your kid, and now you're ready to kill him. You didn't even know that. You follow me? That you had the desire to kill somebody. You didn't even know it was that. You have to go into these things. So, but that's the prasapta vasana. That's dormant, right? So, in ordinary, they don't bother you. You only know they're there because, you know, there's no circumstance or situation that triggered their arising. So, you don't even know about them. Then, there are the next level, and we call those tanu vasanas. Those are weak. You got them. You're aware of them, but they're weak. There's no compulsion to act on them. It would be nice if to have a Rolls Royce, I would love it. But, you know, let me be realistic. You know, I ain't got this kind of money, so it goes. You know, you walk by your window shopping, and you walk by a window, you see a beautiful dress in there, and that you see, oh, man, that really look good on me. But, you know, then you go on by, and it goes. It leaves you alone. Tanu. See my point? It's weak. You see? And then there's the vicinavasana. Vicinavasanas are the kind of desires that come and go. You know, because there's some desires you have that are repeating themselves. It comes, you work on it, then a week later it comes again, you work on it. Then that's like your addiction. You know what I mean? And then there are the what they call the uttara or udara vasana. Those are the ones that are right up front. And they're intense. They're intense to the point of obsession. You gotta have it. Now that's when that desire rises and you have got to fulfill. feel that desire. You got to act on that thing. You see my point? It possesses you. You become obsessed with it. Mm-hmm. So there are different intensities. Mm-hmm. And the thing about the physics of asanas is that whenever you have a desire and you act and you do what is necessary to fulfill that desire, a couple of things happen. One is on the conscious level, the other one, Dal Yasab, is on that unconscious level you were talking about. On the conscious level, when you fulfill that desire, there is some gratification, naturally, some fulfillment. Temporary, of course, but there's some fulfillment nevertheless. Right? On the downside, on the unconscious side, it leaves an impression. We call those samskaras. It leaves an impression. It's a memory of that now. You see, it becomes stored in the chitta, part of the atankaringa, in memory, a samskara, an impression is made. And also at that unconscious level, avasana is created. Vasana is a tendency. Vasanas are your tendencies. So let's say the fulfillment of the desire is pleasant, you like it, it goes into your memory. You remember, boy, that was some good pizza that I got over at Illuminati. You see my point? You remember that. It's Illuminati, not Giordano. That Illuminati pizza. That good pizza, right? So you remember that. That's the impression. And then the vasana would be the tendency to repeat that indulgence. So vasanas are like these tendencies, these predispositions. And all of us are born with certain vasanas. This body is woven around your vasanas. It's wired. Yes, beloved.
Okay, so that relates to another question.
Oh boy!
It would seem that there's a process of grace in this, because to the extent you can see how those things that come into your awareness exercise control over you, at the same time, if you can hold them at a distance and decide to or attempt to dissolve them, I'm just speculating, this is how expanded awareness must destroy karma and make possible for self-realization and not this lifetime.
Yes, very good point, you see. And to be able to stand in that gap, you must be capable of what we call kapasya, that's the inner world. See, in the Yoga Sutra of Patanjali Maharaji, they talk about the yamas and the niyamas, right? Whereby the yamas are those disciplines that we must cultivate in order to interact and transact with the world in a harmonious way, so they won't have all this conflict and shit like that going on in our life that undermines the mind's ability to be made concentrated. Then you have the niyamas, that's the inner work that you do on yourself, the socha, the purification, and so forth and so on, the santosh. And then there's the tapasya, the ability to withstand the fire of purification. Because even though you know all of these things, the vasana, the desire, will arise. And that's where the test is. Now, ultimately, they say in the tradition that that is part of the test of human existence, is to test you, to see if in those moments you can be loved. There's a lot that we can tease out of that statement, but we won't go there today. In that moment, can you not act selfishly for the sake of the fulfillment of your own vasanas? That's a tapasya. You see? That's a preparation. And you can't get there through wishful thinking. You see? even though you may know all of these things. That's why, beloved, in the Avata Bodha Dipaka, where you studied how this process unfolds in the Danta Yoga, but it's like that in all of the yoga. You understand that even after having completed the part and stage of understanding, you understand the Dhamma. You see, you intellectually accept that, but the vasanas has to be annihilated. Vasana kashyaya has to occur. And you can't destroy those through a mere intellectual process. Cannot happen. It's a whole different thing now. And it takes a great deal of strength, discipline, commitment for this annihilation process. That's what the saints meant when they said the process is like dying while living. That's where that phrase come in. Because it's only when you get to that level of sadhana, where you are dealing with the annihilation of the vasanas, do you really appreciate this is dying while living. And that's a whole nother thing. That's a whole nother thing. And if your sadhana has been weak and it is not grounded in the vivika, you have no varajya, you have no capacity for uparapti, none of these things, you'll never make it through there. Cannot happen. You see? Dying while living. Dying to what? The flesh. Dying to yourself. It's Jesus' language. Dying to the flesh. Dying to yourself. Yeah. You see? It's like that. And then comes the liberation. Then comes the realization. Then comes the sakshatkara that Nirvana Devi said that she wanted. Then comes the realization. You see? And after that realization, you see, when you and Brian Saw were saying that when there's the realization of self as consciousness, when that thing is strong, the mind now quiets now because there's nothing to fear. Because nothing is happening to me. You see? That's the part, Brian Saw, when you're saying the mind. In the Asravaka Gita, at some point you see, Asravaka Tilajanaka, you don't even care what's going on in the mind. It has nothing to do with you. That's way down the road. You know what I mean? Mind is not you. Why are you bothered about that? It ain't happening to you. Let the mind, who cares what happens to you? You see? It's not your problem. Way down the road. You see? So you all get a map, right? Now, we probably can stay here much longer because these are the kind of things that goes into a kind of sober assessment of your life and what you will do with your lifetime. You see? And it is your lifetime. It is your coin. It's your time. How are you going to spend this here? Are you going to spend it on bullshit? Just lying to yourself? Or are you going to use human existence for the purpose that you are human? You got to go sit with that. You see, no guru can touch you on the head and do it for you. Gurus point the way. Function of a guru is just that, to dispel darkness. That's the function of a guru. Guru dispels darkness, ignorance, gives you knowledge. Rest is on you. Ain't no touch on the head. You follow me? You can't pray to the guru's palm and be saying, no. That shit is what they do in religion, and it don't work. You got to put in the work. You see? No fooling, no kidding. The guru would dispel ignorance. And that is our unique advantage of having a guru. Yeah. That is the guru grace, the guru kripa. You see? is making themselves available for the sake of us being able to remove our ignorance. That's their grace. They don't have to do that. You see my point? And charging you no fee, right? They don't need it psychologically. You see my point? It's grace. That is the Guru grace. You all think the Guru grace is some kind of magical portion he'll concoct for you to drink and blah, blah, blah. The Guru grace is giving you his time, her time. It is your unique events, and you must consider what will you do with it. Time is going to end, both for the Guru and you. Come to a screeching halt, you see. And for Prasad, I thought we will, actually, Rajavira and I, we were scheming this morning. We thought the weather would be bad enough so that there would only be maybe 7, 8, or 9 of us here. So we had a whole different agenda planned today. So that's done with, right? We'll see. But this particular song gives me something to hold on to that we all are familiar with. That particular shepherd. For me, and maybe for some of you, it exemplifies what those unfortunate souls who have not heard Dharma, have not been given the means by which they can have knowledge, those who are without gurus. It is a depiction in music of what they're going to go through. Those of us who study the Bible, we, you know, the last book in the Bible, what is Revelation, end time. You see, that's about you. There will be an end time here for you. And if you read the book of Revelation, you see, it said that these are the things that will shortly happen. It begins with that verse. Has to happen. And what of you? You're going to lose your body. You're going to lose everything you've been clinging to. Everything. You're going to lose everyone in the world that you say you love. And they're going to lose you. These things, says the book of Revelation, are the things that will shortly happen. Shortly, because a human lifetime is a brief affair. It goes like this, and shortly. Sooner than you think, these are the things that will happen. Your life will fall apart. Pestilence, diseases, you have your cancer, diabetes, emphysema, and every other kind of disease will attack this body of yours shortly. Because these are the things that will happen in your end time. You have an end time. You don't know what time the end time is, but you will know when the end time comes because it has been prophesied. You see, stay, feel this body. It'll tell you when you get close to the end time. You see, notice your memory is gone. You see, you can't hardly remember shit no more. You see, end time coming. Look in the mirror, see all that gray hair you got? End time coming. Stop dying. Get ready for the end time. Feel that pain in your knee? Feel that sugar running all out of whack in you? Yeah. End time coming for you. End time coming. You see? It's revelation. And those who have not gotten the knowledge, have not used their human lifetime for the purpose for which it has been given us, they're not going to have nothing to hold on to. You're going to hear them screaming, begging, please, give me something to hold on to. They're going to be trying to hold on to anything they can because they ain't got nothing. You see? Anything. Give me religion. Don't care if it's foggy, but give me something. Give me something that will want to be. Yeah, because you're in the end time now. You're going to be looking for anything to hold on to. You see? Tell me that there's a cure for my terminal illness down in South America. You see, in some little moat village, and there's a little roof that they have. And just tell me that, and I'll sell my house and mortgage because I fly down there. I got to have something, even if it is just, you know, some superstitious belief in some roof down in South America to save you from this diabetic condition, this cancer. You understand what I'm saying to you?
Yes, sir.
You understand me?
Yes, sir.
And you got to see which group you're going to be in. Are you going to be in that group that is desperate? I mean desperate. Do you see people? Look around yourself. You see people, they desperate. These people are desperate. These people are trying to be happy and they're trying to live forever and they ain't playing around with this shit. You see? They serious. I mean, they desperate here. Are you going to be one of them? Or are you already one of them? Desperate. Unfortunate kind of human being that has wasted their lifetime. And now you are moving into your end time. If you pass 45, you have officially started entering into your end time. In life, they call it midlife crisis. That's what a midlife crisis is. It's the recognition. Oh, shit. End time is coming upon you. You see? And you get frantic in that point. You know what I mean? Now you say, well, man, I ain't got no time left. Let me divorce that ass because I ain't going to be happy with I quit this job. You know what I mean? End time, you start getting this. You start getting radical here now, right? I know guys that when they get 45, they start using drugs. You know, let me smoke something now. You know what I mean? It's end time. I was trying to stay away from these drugs all my life. You know, drugs are bad. End time, get a man, let me find me some coke. You don't know how this is going to go. End time. End time. And you're going to be, like Revelation said, you're going to be looking for refuge under wood, under rocks, all over the place, trying to get yourself something. You have nothing to hold on to. Your PhD ain't gonna do you no good. Your career ain't gonna do you no good. Your relatives, all that mama cotta that you spent your life accumulating, do you no good. Some of us know that. Nadana David and I were just talking about it. You had that stroke. You understood that. All them degrees, all that knowledge, all that big book of business, that shit didn't help you at all. You needed something other than that. You see? Your daughter couldn't get you out of that. Mike Evans couldn't get you out of that. Your book of business couldn't get you out of that. That CPA license couldn't get you out of that. You had a taste of end time. And none of this shit you're doing is going to get you out of that. And if you have wasted your grace of having been given this Dhamma, then you better find you something to hold on to. Because your end time is coming. God bless you. Thank you. softly as fine. Because we don't have to be like those people running around in such desperation when our end time comes, because we've been given something that'll get you through all end time and every challenge that your end time will bring to you, see? And that's been these teachings. And the first thing you fall in love with is these teachings. And at some point in your life, if you're fortunate, you will come to love these teachings, love this stuff. It's like when you have found the right woman in your life, or the right man in your life, when you have found the love of your life. That's what it feels like when you found this Dhamma. You see, that's what the Dhamma should feel like to you, that you have found that missing thing that changes life. You become a bhakta the moment you hear. It's like falling in love at first sight, the moment you heard the first line of the Dhamma, love should have. And we love this Dhamma. And because of my love for the Dhamma, I love the Dhamma giver. The answer to our problems is the Dhamma. No fooling. No kidding. the way you see the miracle where I'm from. But it don't matter, baby, I can feel it here inside. What Dharma does, changes the whole world.
Yes, God. It's true love.
I love it. It's not a woman. It's not a man.
Ever.
Not your children.
Better girl.
Like you can't do this.
So what?
So tender, and your love of it
completely
changed.
You changed me, rearranged me,
did you practice
with no meaning in my life?
Sorry.
No more sadness or madness, no more loneliness,
no more depression.
It's over.
Gives you what you were looking for in the husband.
You changed my whole world.
But you couldn't find it in my heart.
Oh, baby, it's true love.
What you're looking for in all your loveliness, said Holy Ghost.
You changed my whole world. Around and I.
Dance with a more Mooney Riders. Where's he at? Where's this?
Aria.
Aria.
Come in here.
Come in here.
It's over.
You gotta dance with this man.
It's
I like.